Good morning. Today we celebrate the sixth Sunday of Easter under the leadership of the Capuchin Franciscan Friars and in union with the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Philadelphia. St. John's welcomes all who are present with us today in praising God and serving God's people. In this Eucharist, we remember especially the intentions of Father John McCluskey. Our celebrant is Father John McCluskey. As we are about to begin this liturgy, please turn off or silence all paging devices, cell phones, or any other devices that may be a cause of disruption or distraction. Thank you.
Please rise and join me in singing our entrance hymn number 167. Alleluia, Alleluia, let the holy anthem rise. Number 167, Alleluia, Alleluia, let the holy anthem rise.
Alleluia, Alleluia, let the holy anthem rise, and the choirs of heaven chant it in the temple of the skies. Let the mountains skip with gladness, and the joyful valleys ring with hosannas in the highest to our Savior and our King. Alleluia, Alleluia, like the sun from out the wave, he has risen up in triumph from the darkness of the grave. He's the splendor of the nations, he's the lamp of endless day, he's the very Lord of glory, who is risen up today. Alleluia, Alleluia, blessed Jesus, make us rise from the life of this corruption to the life that never dies. May your glory be our portion when the days of time are past, and the dead shall be awakened by the trumpet's mighty blast.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is good for us to be here. It is good for us to be here if we are regular people here who come pretty much every week. It is good for us to be here if we are from elsewhere in the Delaware Valley who happen to be in Center City today, have chosen to worship with us. It is good for us to be here if we are visiting the city from further away and know that St. John's is here welcoming you, affirming you, and that we may pray for each other, pray with each other, and pray for the city and the country and the world. We also welcome the secular Franciscans who are here. There are at least four in the church, and if they raise their hands, secular five, okay. Excellent. I think one back there. The secular Franciscan order used to be called the Third Order, founded by St. Francis in 1210. They've been around for a while, not these particular folks, but but they've been around for a while, living a Franciscan life as lay people in the world. They happen to be meeting today, but I'll ask at the end of Mass if they could go to the back of the church and make themselves known and answer any questions that anyone may have about the secular Franciscan order. As we begin to worship here today together, we begin as always acknowledging that we are sinners, saved by God's grace and mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance, we may always hold to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Some who had come down from Judea were instructing the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the Mosaic practice, you cannot be saved." Because there arose no little dissension and debate by Paul and Barnabas with them, it was decided that Paul, Barnabas, and some of the others should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. The apostles and elders, in agreement with the whole church, decided to choose representatives and to send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. The ones chosen were Judas, who was called Barsabbas, and Silas, leaders among the brothers. This is the letter delivered by them. The apostles and the elders, your brothers, to the brothers in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia of Gentile origin, greetings. Since we have heard that some of our number who went out without any mandate from us have upset you with their teachings and disturbed your peace of mind, we have with one accord decided to choose representatives and to send them to you along with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, who have dedicated their lives to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we are sending Judas and Silas, who will also convey this same message by word of mouth. It is the decision of the Holy Spirit and of us not to place on you any burden beyond these necessities, namely, to abstain from meat sacrificed to idols, from blood, from meats of strangled animals, and from unlawful marriage. If you keep free of these, you will be doing what is right. Farewell. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, God, let all the nations pray. have pity on us and bless us. May he let his face shine upon us. So may your way be known upon earth, among all nations your salvation. O God, let all thy nations praise you. May the nations be glad and exult, because you rule the peoples in equity. The nations on the earth you guide. O God, let all thy nations praise you. May the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. May God bless us, and may all the ends of the earth fear him. O God, let all thy nations praise you.
A reading from the book of Revelation. The angel took me in spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city of Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. It gleamed with the splendor of God. Its radiance was like that of a precious stone, like jasper, clear as crystal. It had a massive high wall with 12 gates where 12 angels were stationed, on which names were inscribed, the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. There were 3 gates facing east, 3 north, 3 south, and 3 west. The wall of the city had 12 courses of stones as its foundation, on which were inscribed the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb. The city had no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gave it light, and its lamp was the Lamb. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever loves me will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word you hear is not mine, but that of the Father who sent me. I have told you this while I am with you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I told you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give it to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. You heard me tell you, I am going away and I will come back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it happens, so that when it happens,
you may believe. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As part of the welcoming, I forgot to mention that we have some number of people who are watching us on live stream, and you are very welcome also. If you can't be here in person, we're glad that you are here remotely. It was just awful. It was terrible. Everyone was upset. Paul and Barnabas were based in Antioch in Syria, the third largest city of the Roman Empire. It was in the Roman province of Syria. Now, if you located the place where it was on the map, it'd be actually in extreme southeastern Turkey. There was a thriving, small Christian community. But there was division. There was upset. There was acrimony. There was confusion. It is as if the folks on this side of the church believed one thing and did enact what they believed. And the people on this side of the church believed something else and lived according to it. The basic issue is, how are we saved? How do we live as Christians? And one half of the church, stirred up by some very sincere people, said, Jesus was Jewish, God revealed himself through the Old Testament, and therefore anyone who follows the way of Jesus must become Jewish. They must be circumcised, the men. They must follow all the Jewish dietary laws. They must follow the Jewish worship laws. And the other side of the church said, we came to follow Jesus as Gentiles, as non-Jews, and we believe in Jesus, and we certainly believe the scriptures were inspired, the Old Testament, but circumcision is a bridge too far. The Jewish dietary laws and other laws of ritual are just too much. We believe we're saved by faith and grace. They couldn't eat together. They had difficulty worshiping together. They tried to follow different rules of life. And the two sides really were not going to be able to live in harmony with one another within this earliest Christian assembly. And we heard in the first reading what they did to resolve this issue. Send Paul and Barnabas to Jerusalem, where the apostles were still there. Confer with them, ask them to solve this issue for us, and they did. They basically said, the ritual laws of the Old Testament did not apply any longer. Circumcision wasn't required to become a Christian. But in order that the community at the time could eat with one another, we ask that you refrain from meat sacrificed to idols, even though we know idols don't exist, And we asked that you not eat meat of strangled animals. And that allowed the two sides to have fellowship with each other, to eat with each other. And the moral law of the Old Testament applying to marriage had to be enforced. It was a key moment in church history, a key moment in scripture about how to deal with disputes. Specifically in the church, but also how to deal with disputes elsewhere by extension. We live in argumentative times, both in the church and in the world. And these arguments happen at all levels, in our country, in our city, our families, within dioceses and parishes. We argue about everything and anything, or we try to avoid creating a ruckus by walking on eggshells and just never saying anything that anyone might find troubling. Any number of people will tell us, or they will tell people on the internet who they don't know and will never meet, exactly what is wrong with them, what they should do or what they should never do, what they should believe, what they should not believe. And there's almost an expectation of we Americans that we're supposed to have strong and decisive opinions about things we cannot control. Even about things we cannot influence, even about things that don't affect us. And if something does affect us, wow, we really have opinions. We use the language of extremes. We talk about wars against this or that idea. We use the word fight so frequently. We hear that opponents are all evil, or the people who agree with us are all good. When if we open our eyes, we know that everybody is in some way a mixture of good and evil. We are all sinners, and we all who have been baptized are redeemed in Christ. In this climate, it's hard for ideas to be subtle or nuanced or even precise. It's hard for our language to be mild. It is hard for people to be meek. When this harsh language enters the church, Jesus weeps. He wept over the city of Jerusalem. He commanded us to love one another. But so often, in church or in the world, we seem to think that our task is to tear into people. Always tearing into people in groups who are different from us, because we're the good ones, however we define our own group. We forget that those people in those groups are loved by God just as much as we are. That Jesus died to redeem them just as much as he died to redeem me and you. There are those who will proudly announce in our land that God is on their side and that opposing them is opposing God. You know, the commandment reads, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Now that has some marginal relationship to what you say when you hit your finger with a hammer or lock the keys in the car. But that's not really what it's about. It is taking the name of God and announcing that it is God's design, God's will, to say or do something that is not God's will. And anyone who does that needs to be really very, very careful and cautious about what they say and what they do. Pentecost is in 2 weeks' time. Let us look at what this reading, what lessons this reading from Acts can teach us. First, second, third, fourth, all the way to last. Start with love. Start with charity. If words are expressed in unloving and uncharitable ways, that's fun sometimes. We can climb up on our soapbox. We can say whatever we want. We feel so righteous and so good. But that's not what it's about. We must act with love. If someone knows you love them, you can say anything to them. If someone thinks you do not love them, it doesn't matter what you say to them. They won't hear you. Let me quote from a theologian, von Balthasar, the favorite theologian, I'm told, of Pope Benedict. Let there be no doubt. We are here to love God and our neighbor. And this love does not require us to submit just one part of our lives to its demands and leave the rest for us to follow whatever we want to do. It does not allow us to dedicate just one period of our lives to love, acting lovingly, but all of our life and all aspects of our life. The command to love is universal and makes demands on everything. Our whole heart, our whole soul, our whole strength. Second lesson, live prayerfully. Not just a few words said, but live prayerfully. Do nothing without prayer, deep prayer, silent prayer. Open to the leadings of the Spirit. Not praying that our side wins, not praying that that other side will see the error of their ways, but praying that the Lord's will be manifest to all of us, that side and our side. To pray that the Lord's will be done and that we come to understand better, and they understand better, what is the Lord's will. In the Our Father, we pray, thy will be done. But sometimes we're tempted to actually act as if we're praying, Lord, change your will to my will. Let my will be done. Third, when there are disputes, stop talking. Start listening. Deeply listen. Try to understand what people are really saying, what they really mean, what they really believe, why they believe it. Try to understand what they are hoping for and what they are afraid of. And then when it is our time to speak, or write, or tweet, or post, be respectful. Fourth, seek the truth. Jesus is the truth, and everything in the church and in the world must be built on truth, not on rumor, not on suppositions or assumptions, not on what we think is just logical, not on what we think about people in groups that we've never really listened to or spoken with. Anything that's not fully grounded in the truth is not holy, not righteous, not of the Spirit. Never insult, condemn, or assume. Fifth, in matter of faith and morals, seek the counsel of the church's leaders, especially the bishops. They are the successors of the apostles. They are and have the right and the duty to preserve unity as they did in that gathering in Jerusalem, to resolve disputes within the church, to interpret the will of the Spirit, finally, after discernment, and to give the church's teaching on faith and morals. That doesn't mean that every bishop's statement is always right or sensible. Back in my 20s, I'm a late vocation, back in my 20s, I really was on the far periphery of the church. And every time I thought about coming back into active practice of the faith, I'd read in some newspaper or hear on some TV that some dumb bishop said some dumb thing, and I'd pull back. Truthfully, I don't even know that the bishop said that. All I know is someone reported that they said it, or said that they said it, or whatever. But I came to realize eventually that I was letting the press account about some dumb bishop somewhere hold my faith hostage. I respect bishops, but I am saved by Jesus Christ. My faith is in the triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit. It's not in any particular person, human being, who has a church office. Listen to the Spirit. The Spirit of truth cannot contradict himself, and the Spirit may be doing something new, as he did here in this reading in Acts. Think about the middle way. When the church was divided then, in divisions now within Catholicism, within Christianity, within our political world, our social world, it seems that people want to run to the extreme, assuming that the extreme, whichever way we're running, has got to have the true, the truth. And yet so often in the history of the church and the history of ideas and the history of social relations and political relations tells us that the middle way, not just splitting the difference, but the middle way, finding the path of bringing things together, is the path that the Lord leads us to. Finally, understand that the overall trajectory in the Acts of the Apostles, in the early church, in the first centuries, and throughout its history, the overall trajectory is toward inclusion, not exclusion, toward bringing people in, not finding ways to keep them out, toward easing their burdens, not adding to them. And that overall trajectory within Christianity has influenced, and many would argue is the source of, the overall trajectory of political systems and social systems, of bringing people in, of recognizing that we're all created in the image and likeness of God with dignity and respect, and that we are to live that. Of course, the church at times has made mistakes. Of course, governments have at times made mistakes. Of course, even the people in my family whom I love have made mistakes at times. But we don't exclude and we don't write off. We embrace. We listen. We talk. That's what was done in Jerusalem in the first century. That's what we can do. To be agents ourselves of reconciliation. And certainly not to add to the clamor that we're surrounded with, the harshness, the condemning. Does this reading cast light on how we might think of the current issues in the church and the world? I hope so.
Let us profess the faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As sons and daughters of the Most High God, we have the right and the privilege to address him in prayer on behalf of ourselves, on behalf of our families, on behalf of the church, on behalf of all people. And so we lift up our prayers to the Father.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For Pope Francis, that the Holy Spirit will continue to be his source of strength and wisdom as he seeks to heal a divided world and church. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peaceful and just resolutions to conflicts around the world, especially armed conflicts that keep people in a state of fear and helplessness. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the gift of forgiveness and reconciliation, so that hurts may be healed and peace and harmony may be experienced by everyone. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For children of our various communities, that they may be kept safe, healthy, and cared for. May parents instill within the hearts of their children a true love of Christ, care, and respect for others. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our family members, friends, and all who have completed their mission here on earth, may they be rewarded with peace and happiness forever in heaven. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions in our book of prayer and those that each of us offers now in silence. and for the intentions of Father John McCluskey, remembered especially in this Eucharist. In faith, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
I'd like you also, please, to pray for me and the other friars of the province. We are gathering tomorrow for 5 days in chapter. We will, at that point, elect a new provincial, a new regional leader, a new council of advisors for him. We will talk about what ministries we currently have that we may wish to relinquish, what ministries that have been offered to us that we may wish to accept, and various issues within our life as Capuchin Franciscan friars. So please pray with me. Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty Father, generous, merciful, just God, we ask these things, always, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please join me in singing our offertory hymn number 329, Gift of Finest Wheat. Number 329, Gift of Finest Wheat.
Satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come, give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to eat. As when the shepherd calls his sheep, they know and heed his voice. So when you call your family, Lord, follow and rejoice. You satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come, give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to eat. With joyful lips we sing to you our praise and gratitude, that you should count us worthy, Lord, to share this heavenly food. You satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come, give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to is not the cup we bless and share, the blood of Christ abhorred. Do not one cup, one loaf declare our oneness in the Lord. You satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come, give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to eat. The mystery of your presence, Lord, no mortal tongue can tell, whom all the world cannot contain, comes in our hearts to dwell. Satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come, give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to eat.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. You take away who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. John the Evangelist, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Nelson our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Please join me in singing our communion hymn, number 394, Here I Am, Lord. Number 394, Here I Am, Lord.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark. I will make the darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send?
I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. When shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who restores us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A couple of things to announce. The friars, all of us, will be away this week. We have some diocesan priests living here who will be pinch hitting for us. We will be back on Friday or Saturday, depending upon individual travel plans. Please keep us in your prayers this week. There's a little bit of an adjustment in the schedule that the usual Eucharistic adoration and evening prayer will not happen this week, but the sequence of confessions will happen on Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, not on Thursday, and the masses at the usual times in the lower or the upper church, as the case may be. Thursday is Ascension Thursday. So we have the Vigil Mass at 5:45. We have masses at 7:45 in the morning. We have masses at 12:05 and at 5:15 in the evening of the Holy Day. All of this is in the bulletin if you choose to take one. It is also on the website, stjohnsphilly.org, and that is always up to date, thanks to Abe up here in the choir loft, who is managing the video for this this live stream. And in the back of the church, also on the website, also in the bulletin, you'll see a reference to a pilgrimage I'm leading to Italy next May. Anyone who might be interested, please check that out. There are brochures in the back of the church. I'd ask that the secular Franciscans who are willing and are anywhere near the main aisle may join the procession out of the church following the cross, and they'll be there to answer any questions that you may have about this order that has had so much to do with the life of the church for 800 years. I think they've got it down pretty good by now. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go announce the gospel by your lives. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Please join me in singing our recessional hymn number 488, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Number 488, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Without ceasing.